गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन एंड वेलकम बैक टू द स्टडीज. इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी वर स्टडिंग अबाउट द एवोल्यूशन ऑफ द यूएन, हाउ यूनाइटेड नेशन केम इनटू एग्जिस्टेंस. इट्स टाइमलाइन वाज डिस्कस्ड. देन वी वर डिस्कसिंग द प्रिंसिपल ऑर्गन्स ऑफ द यूनाइटेड नेशंस एंड नाउ वी विल डिस्कस द मेन ऑब्जेक्टिव for which the UN has come into existence. The UN's objective is to prevent international conflicts, and conflicts can be prevented only when there will be cooperation among the member states. So it is also the objective of the UN to facilitate the cooperation among the member states. So it was the expectation of the whole world that when the UN will come into existence, then it will stop conflicts between states, so that it should not take the form of a war. And if in spite of the effort by the UN the war breaks out, then in that case what should be the objective of the UN? In that case, the objective of the UN should be to limit the extent of hostilities. So these are the main objective for which UN has come into existence. Apart from this, these objectives, UN has also some social and economic objectives also, because it has been experienced that war becomes the consequences of the lack of social and economic development of the countries. So if the UN starts focusing on the social and economic development of the member state, then the possibility of war will reduce itself. So the another objective of the UN is to help the member nations in achieving social and economic development. So now we see that UN had, in your book it is given that 192 members, but actually UN had 193 members. South Sudan is the latest member, and I have told you earlier when I was discussing the main organs of the United Nations that in General Assembly all the member states have equal vote, or every member state send one of its representatives to the UN General Assembly, and all the member countries have one vote, and all the and the value of all the votes are similar. Any decision is taken by the majority, simple majority of the assembly, but special decisions are taken by two-third majority of the assembly. But General Assembly is just only a platform to discuss. It does not have any binding authority over the member countries. And in UN Security Council, what we find that there are five permanent members, and these are United States, Russia, United Kingdom, France, and China. And apart from these five permanent members, there are another non-permanent members who are appointed for 10 years. So these are the countries which are selected as permanent members are were the most powerful countries at that time when the UN was coming into existence, and so they become the most powerful countries of the world. Now we also discussed that the Secretary General is secretariat is just the office of the UN. UN is such a huge organization, and it is supposed to do so many works, so it is it requires an office, and that office is called secretariat, and the head of that secretariat is Secretary General. At present, the Secretary General of UN is Antonio Guterres, who appointed as the Secretary General on 1st January 2017. In your book, it is given Ban Ki-moon, who was appointed on 1st January 2007 and who was on the post for two consecutive terms. And in 2017, Antonio Guterres took over the post. He was appointed as Secretary General. So these are the important things about the UN. Then what we find that UN acts not only through its different organs, but it also has many special agencies. And through these special agencies, UN does its social and economic responsibility. So UN fulfills its social and economic responsibilities. There are many such agencies of UN. Suppose, for example, World Health Organization, United Nations Development Programme, United Nations Human Rights Commission, United Nations High Commission for Refugees, United Nations Children's Fund, and United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization. So these are its special agencies. Now, what we find that UN came into existence in the year 1945, and today, presently, we are in 2020. So, with the passage of time, there is many world politics. The scenario of world politics has also changed, and with this, there is demand of reform of the UN, especially after the end of the Cold War. There is a demand of reform of the UN. So reform in UN, it means reform in the structure and process of the UN. What do you mean by structure and process? Structure and process means actually the UN's most powerful organ is Security Council. So there is demand to reform the structure of United Nations and the process, and there is also demand for the reform in the process also. And there is another demand. That demand is regarding the jurisdiction of the UN. Nowadays, there are many countries who believe that UN, the jurisdiction of UN now should be limited only to political and only to economic, social, and environmental spheres only. It should not do any. It should not have any jurisdiction in the political field. Whereas there are many countries who believe that UN has political responsibilities also. It must have its jurisdiction in the political matters also. So, in our studies, only the reform of structure and process is important. So we are focusing on that reform only. And here you must understand that whenever we talk of the reform of structure and process, the demand is for the restructuring of United Nations Security Council, because it is the most powerful organ of the Security Council. And as we know, there are five permanent members in the United Nations Security Council. And so what is the demand? What reforms are demanded? The most important demand is that there should be increase in the UN Security Council's permanent and non-permanent membership. Because when it came into existence at that time, only five countries were most powerful, and those five countries got permanent membership in the Security Council. But with the passage of time, and there many developments took place in the international politics, and we see that in 1991, Soviet Union disintegrated and the Cold War ended. And in this context, there is a need of a restructuring of the United Nations Security Council. And then there are some other demands also in the context of process, and the demand is done by US and other Western countries that there should be improvement in the United Nations budgetary procedure and its administration. So, in this context, we must understand that our main focus is on the reform of the United Nations Security Council, and that too, we are mainly concerned with the increase in the number of permanent members. So, now what we see that this is the list of UN Secretary General, starting from the first Secretary General to the it is Kofi Annan is there, and after Kofi Annan, Ban Ki-moon became the Secretary General, and after that, presently Antonio Guterres is there. So this is the list of Secretary Generals of UN. Now, what we find that what changes has occurred in the what changes has occurred in the world politics, which are compelling to change the structure of UN Security Council, and these changes are it is given in your book in a very precise manner. You can see it here. The Soviet Union has collapsed. The US is the strongest power. The US is the only superpower in the world politics at present. The relationship between Russia, the successor to the Soviet Union, and the US is much more cooperative. What we see that during the Cold War era, there was animosity between the US and USSR, and but after the end of Cold War, after the disintegration of USSR, Russia became the successor of Soviet Union, and at present we see that US and Russia are having a cooperative relationship. They are having good relationship. So this is a big change in the world politics. Then next, what we see that China is fast emerging as a great power. China is emerging as the next superpower to America. And India is also growing rapidly. Its economy is growing at a very high rate, and it is also becoming a big economic power. Then other changes are also there. The economies, economies of Asia are growing at an unprecedented rate. The, overall, we can see that the various countries of Asia are doing very well in the context of economy, and the whole Asia is growing at an unprecedented rate. Then what we see that many new countries came into existence after the end of Cold War, and these new countries have joined United Nations. So the membership of the UN has also increased. A whole new set of challenges confronts the world. Now there are the war, possibility of war has become very less because of nuclear weapon. In this era of nuclear weapon, it, we cannot think of the Third World War, because the effect of the, if Third World War happens, then its effect will be so devastating that no one will remain there to get any kind of benefit from the war. So there is very less possibility of Third World War, and war is not a challenge for today's world. In today's world, there are other problems which have become, which are much more challenging than the war. And these problems are like ethnic struggle, civil war, genocide, then terrorism is there, nuclear proliferation, climate change, environmental degradation, epidemics. These are all more challenging problems in the today's world. So keeping all these facts in mind, what we find that the present structure, present composition of United Nations Security General is Security Council is not sufficient. It needs to be changed. There is a need of reform. If it does not change, then it will become irrelevant. So there is huge demand for its reformation. And what we see that in 1992, the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution. And in this resolution, there was three main complaints were there. The first complaint is the Security Council no longer represents contemporary political realities. Whatever changes has been taken place in the contemporary world politics, the Security General is the Security Council is not representing those changes. And then we find that its decisions reflect only Western values and interests and are dominated by a few powers. The decisions of the Security Council are only the decisions of the Western world. Why? Because Western powers are dominating the whole United Nations. And in this way, it is not a democratic, it has no more a democratic institution. Then the last is it lacks equitable representation. In this United Nations, there is representation is not equitable. It means there are many continents which are unrepresented in the Security Council. For example, Africa, Latin America, these are the continents from where not a single member is the permanent member of Security Council. So in the changed scenario, there is a need of reform in the United Nations Security Council. Now, what we find that on 1st January 1997, the then Secretary General of UN, Kofi Annan, he has initiated an inquiry and how the UN should be reformed. So now what happens that everyone was aware, everyone was knowing the fact that there is need to reform the UN. But no one was knowing that how to bring this reform. What should be the criteria if we want to increase the number of permanent members in the Security Council? Then on what basis, on what criteria new members should be included in the Security Council? That was not clear to anyone. Everyone was talking about this, yes, that reform must be there, it should be reformed and all this kind. But what should be the criteria? That was not clear to anyone. And in this direction, what we see that some of the criteria that have been proposed for new permanent and non-permanent members of the Security Council. Some proposals has been given for permanent and non-permanent members of the Security Council. A new member, it has been suggested, should be. Following are the criteria which if all these criteria are met by any country, then it should get a permanent position, a permanent membership in the Security Council. So the first criteria is a major economic power. The country should be a major economic power. Its economy should be very strong from the point of view of GDP and all the sectors should be in such a situation that it can be said to be a major economic power. Then it should be a major military power. Its military capability should be very high and it must have its military influence upon the world. And then the third criteria is a substantial contributor to the UN budget. The country who wants to be a permanent member, the country must contribute a large portion to the UN budget. Then a big nation in terms of its population. Population should be also large. Then a nation that represents that respects democracy and human rights. For being a permanent member of the Security Council, a nation must respect democracy and human rights, and a country that would make the council more representative of the world's diversity in terms of geography, economic system, and culture. So what is the criteria? That that country should be included as a member of a Security Council. By inclusion of that country, the world organization, the international organization, the United Nations organization should become more diverse in terms of geography. It means from all the continent there should be representation. In terms of economic system means capitalism and communism is there. So different and mixed economy is also there. So from different economic system, country should be there, and from different culture, country should be there. So these are the criteria which are suggested for being a permanent member of Security Council. Now, this criteria is not sufficient. It's not. There are many loopholes in this criteria. And what are these loopholes? We can see that it is said that the country should be a big, major economic power. But major economic power, what does it mean? How big it should be, isn't it? How big it should be for being a permanent member of the country, of the Security Council? Then it is said that it should be a big military power. That is also very vague criteria. And there is nothing which is concrete regarding this criteria. Then the third criteria is the substantial contributor to the UN budget. It should contribute substantially in the UN budget. But what level of budget contribution would enable a state to buy its way into the council? It's like if you are contributing, if you are contributing more in the union, in the UN budget, then there is more possibility of your being a permanent member. So in a way, what is it? It is just like buying your permanent seat. You are purchasing your permanent seat by contributing more and more in the budget of the UN. So the criteria which are suggested are full of loopholes, are full of weaknesses. Then the next point is a big nation in terms of its population. Large population can never and can not always be an asset. It can be liability also. So it is also not clear in the suggestion. Then it is said that a nation that respects democracy and human rights, but it is also not a clear cut about this criteria, because there are many countries who respect democracy and human rights, but on this criteria they cannot be given the permanent seat in a Security Council. Now it is also said that the next point is that the members should represent the diversity of the world in terms of geography. So it means that equitable representation in geographical terms. It means that there should be one seat each from Asia, Africa, and Latin America, and the Caribbean. Should the representation, on the other hand, be by reason or sub-reasons? Why should we think of continent? we can think on the terms of regions also, we can think on the terms of sub-regions also. Why there should be one member from Asia? Why there should not be one member from South Asia? Why there should not be one member from Southeast Asia? Why there should not be one member from Middle East? So these are the points of controversy. So how can be this be decided? The issue of equitable representation on the basis of geography, how it will be decided? On the basis of continent or on the basis of regions or sub-regions? So these are the problems in these criteria. So then it is also said that why we can choose the we can give the permanent membership to the people to the countries on the basis of level of economic development also, but in there also we will face many problems, because what we find, first of all, what we find that all the permanent members are the developed countries of the world. Developing countries are not represented in the Security Council. So there is we can say that countries belonging to developing countries, developing world, should be given representation in the Security Council. But here again the problem will arise. What type of problem will it be? It will be a problem of this, that at many different levels of countries are at many different levels of development. They are developing, but the level of development is still different in each country. So that cannot be decided what level of development should be there. Then again one more point was there, that the country should be given permanent members, so that in this way that they promote the cultural diversity. In this there will be problem also. Should different countries or civilizations be given representation in a more balanced way? How does one divide the world by civilization or cultures, given that nations have so many cultural stream within their borders? In present day, we cannot say that a particular country is having only single culture, because in a single country, what we find that there mixture of culture is existing. All kinds of culture are existing in the same country. So that is also not possible. So in this way, we find that whatever criteria is suggested for the for a country to be a permanent member of United Nations is not a suitable, and it is full of loopholes and weaknesses. Now there is an related issue, and this issue is regarding change the nature of membership altogether. And what is this nature of membership? Now this is the nature of membership is the power of veto. What we find that the five permanent members of the UN has veto power, and now there is demand, when we demanding the to reform the structure and process of Security Council, then it is demanded that veto power should be abolished. There should not be veto power to any of the members. There should not be any discrimination on the basis of this permanent and non-permanent members. Veto should be abolished. It is demanded by many in order to reform the United Nations. So because why this demand is made? Because it is against the concept of democracy. It is against the concept of equality. Yeah, all countries, all member countries of the UN are equal. They all are sovereign members. So why only five countries have the veto power? There should we can't give a veto power to all the countries. Then in that case, what is the appropriate way? The appropriate way is to abolish the veto. In this way, we can make UN more democratic, and it will be work on the principle of equality. But this is also not true, because veto is very much important and relevant for us. It will be discussed tomorrow. We will tell you, I will tell you about the importance of veto, why we cannot abolish veto, what is the utility of veto. It will all will be discussed tomorrow. You all please not only just watch the video carefully, and then read the chapter also, and underline the lines which are important. Or if you are not able to understand any of the sentences, or you are not able to comprehend the meaning of the sentences, then please ask me through in our online classes. It is my request. Make use of time, because this time is if you waste this time, then you will repent in the future. So just make use of time. And now we will do our class tomorrow. Okay.